Hey, everybody, and welcome to the Rocksmith 2014 live stream. A day early. Thank you for noting all the time changes. We have a big company meeting tomorrow during our standard time that we would normally be streaming. So rather than cancel the whole darn thing, and since Friday didn't work out for anybody, we decided to go up a day early. So thanks for being here. You are going to be rewarded with some excellent music, a special guest or two, perhaps. He may or may not look familiar, but we'll get to that after we go through this. And of course, we have plenty of giveaways from Ernie Ball. We've got DLC for this week's mixtape song pack. And well, why don't we take a look at what those songs are in the mixtape song pack. Here's the trailer for this week's DLC. It's available now on all platforms. And when we come back, first song of the four that we'll be playing, and we'll talk to that guy. Thanks for coming up.
Another cup of wine. God.
That's what we've got on tap for this week. The Mixtape Song Pack, 5 songs available now, and we're going to play 4 of them right now over the next hour or so. Sam Schwartz is joining us on the wing. Hi, Sam.
How's it going, guys?
On the bass and now taking center stage because in the previous thing he was in a different chair. Paul Cross, ladies and gentlemen. You may not know him. I'm going to get this right. You are our designer of game... The designer
director
of game development. The director of game design. I knew there were 2 D's in it. It was a director of design or something, and that's what it is. The director of game
director
design.
Director of game design, yes.
Hi, and welcome.
Hi.
Basically, if you don't know, Paul is kind of Rocksmith. So you haven't been on for a long time.
That's true.
Right. That's absolutely true.
2009, sure, when we first started, but. I mean, Rocksmith has been taken by a group of incredibly talented individuals.
Oh, that's very kind of you to say. Who are they, and where can we find them?
Downstairs.
Oh, all right. we're upstairs, just so you know. So, Paul, you are one of the people who not only helped build and actually envision what the Rocksmith experience should be, but you also wound up basically learning how to play guitar through Rocksmith.
Yes, which normally I would like to have practiced a bit, but due to some technical issues, I haven't rehearsed, so you're about to see me sight read.
Yes.
Which is going to be interesting.
That's okay. We welcome that, and we have a very supportive chat room who will support Paul sort of blind reading. Hooked on a Feeling by Blue Swede, which is going to be our first song. Sam, you did the note track.
I did.
Does he have anything to worry about? He's doing the representative arrangement.
Right. So there's an alternate lead where it's all the authentic stuff that the guitar player plays, which is really tricky. Like it's really there's a
but
lot
we're not
going
doing
on.
That.
We're not doing that. and I felt like this song really was great for a vocal melody, right? Because it's just so singable. And like for the first third of the song or quarter of the song or something like that, there's no instrumentation. It's just
Uka Shaka. Do I get to Uka Shaka?
Yeah. No, you don't get to Uka Shaka. You get to do what the vocalist, the lead vocalist is doing. You're not Uka Shaka-ing.
Okay.
And part of me wanted, I actually did try to do it with the bass. I was like, I tried to make that note, and I was like, nah, it's not going to work. There's no Uka Shakas represented in any of the parts,
that's
unfortunately.
Okay.
But you can sing along all you like.
Yeah, you can Uka Shaka.
You can Uka Shaka into your mic.
Yeah,
yes. In fact, people are saying that you're a little too far away from the mic, and they'd like to hear you more. Is that okay? Is that comfortable?
Is that better?
The dulcet British tones.
I think that's what you said to me last time. You're too far away from the
mic. Yeah, well, everybody's afraid of the microphone except for me.
Okay.
And I don't need it. It could be over there and you'd still hear me because I project.
Shy, quiet.
All right. So do you want to just dive in? Is there anything else that you want to say? You just like he was like, nope, I'm calling. You called right of first refusal. You're like, oh, no, I want to play Unhooked on a Feeling. And unfortunately, you Steam players know that last night Steam had some unusual issues and it caused DLC to not really work out. Those have been resolved today by Steam. Thank you, Steam, for taking care of that. Not something that we controlled, but it was something that affected Paul because he went home to practice Hooked on a Feeling, couldn't do it. So that's why Paul is not because he didn't want to prepare. It's that technical issues stopped you from preparing.
Watching the Warriors game. Laptop open, guitar in lap, happy man. Couldn't
until it says no. Just a pop-up box that says no.
So I played for a bunch of other songs. So all it was right. Fun. Still fun.
Well, let's give it a shot then. Hooked on a Feeling from Blue Swede by Paul Cross and Sam Schwartz here at the official Rocksmith live stream from Ubisoft Studio San Francisco, where we make the game. It's true.
So that's what I was going to do.
Ooga, shaka, ooga, ooga, ooga,
it didn't work.
Ooga,
shaka, that's why it's not in there.
I can't stop this feeling deep inside of me. Girl, you just don't realize what you do to me.
Oops.
When you nobody heard that.
In your arms so tight, you let me know. Everything's all right.
Hoffner the Dragon says, I've never seen a Music Man with TJ pickups. This is a Music Man Caprice. It is a current production model they introduced a year or two ago.
But I don't know.
Oops. When we're all alone, keep it up, girl. Okay, I'm gonna need to figure that bit out. Yeah, you turn me on. Ah, what kind of feeling? I'm high on.
Sounds great. All the good love.
When we're all alone. You know I'm not doing your appraisal, right?
I do now.
Bisco Bit says Paul's got the bends down. He's the Rocksmith Whisperer. Sorry, I didn't mean to crack you up, but
I don't think you're doing his review either, right?
No, but okay. Well, maybe. I was going to say it is. Yeah. It's an alias.
I was going to say, we're at that time in the Ubisoft year where we have to do evaluations for employees, and Paul, obviously wearing the largest crown, has to do a lot of evaluations. So, are you doing my evaluation?
No, Dan.
Because if you okay,
can be
you're not
you normal
okay,
and regular.
Okay, I can be because that was okay. You know,
it was all right. Not
no,
bad,
no. Are
not
you kidding?
Bad.
That was fine. No, you got 88%, and you were blind reading. That's fantastic for a cold read. Look, wonderful.
You know how much I love Rocksmith.
I do.
And it was kind of funny. As I said last night, I booted up, and I haven't been playing as much as I should, as much as I actually want to. And last night I booted up. I had a good reason to. So there I was. Couldn't find the song I wanted to play.
Well,
which
there's a thousand.
I know it happens.
You know.
I know there were 1,016 in my library.
Oh, thank you very much.
And I, and I sat there and went, okay, well, I'll just play for a bit. I put it in nonstop play, half an hour, one more song, restarted, did another half an hour, and just kept playing. And my wife was going, sitting there, just sort of nodding along, going, that's pretty
good.
Cool.
That's good.
The wife nod is like serious. It was seriously a good thing. Yeah, when you get a wife nod, it's like, you're just like, all right. It doesn't matter what you're doing, just a wife nod is. Good
some
job.
Kind of kudos. Some of the kudos I really
right, yeah, yeah, exactly.
Because
yeah.
She writes my review.
Oh.
Do you want to tell us anything awesome about the future of Rocksmith? Because I don't think you're allowed, no.
You're telling me not to.
Yeah, that was subtle. Just bait. I was just trying to get you. Yeah.
There is a future of Rocksmith.
There is a future of Rocksmith.
I think that's,
can say
you know,
that.
We hired a number of new people here recently, and one of the things they said is that, when did Rocksmith come out? And we go, okay. And then you have to take a moment to think, oh, hang on a minute, it was 4 years ago.
Yeah.
And it's amazing. Again, people said it wouldn't work. And here we are with the second version continuing to sell 4 years later.
Yeah. And constantly being improved. So there's that.
Thank you to the guys here in San Francisco for making it. And thank you to all of you for playing it and caring and believing in us, because it's awesome. I love it. I'm glad you do.
Yeah. If it wasn't for you viewers, we wouldn't have anybody to sell DLC to. Well, that's a bit more mercenary. No, I know you did. But that's my role on this show is to basically pull the rug out from my guests. That's what happens.
Well,
I'm
not bombshell. I'm going to go and work on the future.
Okay, you go handle that. Now everybody's going to be like, confirmed. Nothing's confirmed. He's working on other stuff. However, we will give you some free stuff if you'd like to do some free stuff. This is what we've got for you. The Ernie Ball Prize Pack. We'll have two of these over the course of the show. One of them right gosh darn now. Everything you see here is going to go home with one winner. And I don't care where you live. You can be in America. You can be in the Europes, perhaps Australia. You can be wherever. We do not have any one of those like weird things where you have to give people, you have to live in a specific territory. We will try to ship you this prize no matter where you live. And you're going to get everything you see here. That includes the brand new strap. At the moment, they are silver, which is pretty cool because that'll match just as easily as black will on anything else. Plus, you've got the peg winder. Sorry, I'm wandering around the studio. You're not seeing me, but I'm actively moving because I'm a professional, eh? The peg winder, which makes changing strings so much better. And hey, how about some new strings to go with the peg winder, both for your guitar and your bass, plus a dozen picks from Ernie Ball, plus the Wonder Wipe system, which cleans and beautifies your guitar, and plus, most importantly, the very rare Rocksmith 1,000 Milestone Picks. We'll send you three of those. All of this can be yours if you win. Just listen for what our friend Ubi Vertigo is saying in our chat room. And it's You Love Travis, right? I believe You Love Travis is our moderator today because Doug had a meeting too. And, you know, like, what are you going to do? We'll make it work. That's it. So send all the information that you all the winning information that you are requested of. If you win the MooBot thing, we need your name, your address, and your phone number, and then send them to You Love Travis in a private message, and making sure that you are in fact the person who was picked, and then he'll send it from there. He'll send it to me, and then I'll get those prize boxes out of this place as humanly possible. Hi, Jason Kokel.
Hello, how are you?
Woefully unprepared. Our next song, I was really excited to play bass on, and I've had a pretty crazy busy week at work. So I did not get a chance to practice this at all. This is Come and Get Your Love by Redbone, which was actually a song I was not familiar with until about 2 years ago, 3 years ago. As much as I thought I knew classic rock, this one slipped through my fingers. That doesn't look like it's too crazy as bass lines go when I'm looking at the horizon. Is there anything I need to know bass-wise?
Yeah, it's harder than the horizon looks.
Oh, great. Thanks. Okay. We're going down smiling today.
It's pretty involved. It's a pretty involved part, but I think you can do it.
All right. Is it fingered or picked?
I can't remember. I think it's fingered.
I think it is. I'm going to have fingered. A pick here just in case.
Just in case.
Guitar-wise, what are you looking forward to? The electric sitar part on this.
Yeah. The sort of quasi-clavinet sitar sounding twangy. It's cool. So, yeah, the lead arrangement here is sort of a... The lead guitar doesn't play throughout, so there's some parts where it plays rhythm. But yeah, it's mostly all the little fills and the little like, it's pretty neat. It's a cool little part. You know, I think this song is it's classic. Very good.
Let's do it. Come and Get Your Love by Redbone. Again, full apologies because I am truly blind reading this in a way that I have not done on the stream in a long time. So I will try to. It looks like it's giving me a hint. It shows 7, 8, 9, 10, which is where I should be placing my fingers. Oh, it's the full album version, too.
Yep.
There's the riff, I got it.
Mm-hmm.
Where did that come from? That would have gone better if I had practiced, but it did not go as bad as I thought it was going to go. I'm sure if you were watching, you could see sort of it dawn on my face, like, oh, this is what my fingers are supposed to be doing. So I'm guessing I was maybe 83 for bass, if I had to put too fine a point on it, because I got a lot of misses.
You got more than 83.
Oh my goodness gracious, really? It was 94. It felt like I wasn't in the pocket. Like that's got us a good pocket, and it's something that I was like, oh, this feels so good when I get it right. Mm-hmm. But I just kept feeling like I was missing pickup notes or other things in there, but... All right, I'll take 94 on a blind read.
That's great. Yeah, it's straightforward enough, but there's some twists and turns to that little bass part.
There was a couple times he went up to the blue string. It was like, hey, I think I'm going to play up here.
Yeah, having some fun.
Very choppy staccato rhythm on this one, almost funky.
Yeah, yeah. What's neat about that is that since it is just all quarter notes, you can take some liberties and add some extra rhythms as long as you're nailing the quarter notes. You can... You know, what I mean? Do that, and it'll work. The other thing that you may notice, and actually, I think I saw it mentioned in the chat when the preview video was playing. Mm-hmm. Someone made a comment about the B minor 7 chord and the fact that it's not barred, and that's very good. I'd like to talk about that for a second, because so when I was watching. I watched some old videos of the band when they were performing. I think it was on like Midnight Special or something like that. They played on, which was a great show. I was watching the singer because I want the singer is playing the rhythm guitar part, and I watched the exact voicings that he was doing, and then I saw him get to this B minor 7 chord, and it hits. He voices it exactly like that, where it's the fifth is on top, and there is no fifth here, and it does a string skip, so it's sort of muting this.
Right. Oh, it's a beautiful chord.
Yeah, it's great, and it's really great. But you have to really be comfortable with that chord because it's basically a D major chord with a B in the bass, and so it becomes B minor 7, but it's D major open that's played with the wrong
three fingers.
Normally you play it with these, and so you really have to be used to that. When I was looking at it downstairs, I was like, I am not doing that. What I'm doing is a barred B minor 7 chord with this, has all the same notes, but an extra note, passage detection, perfect. More comfortable for me.
So you can cheat it. Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, it's not really cheating. I'm adding an extra note. So in some ways, I am playing more than is expected of me.
You get extra credit. You get flair.
Yeah, but also, I mean, that's the thing. Like, and I was watching the singer do it, and he's very comfortable with that shape. He nails it every time. And I was like, well... That's great that it's comfortable for his fingers, but it's not for me. So I decided to it's a B minor 7. I'm just gonna play it like that. No big deal. So, but the rest of the song has, I think it's fairly straightforward. It's a fairly straightforward chord progression, and the licks aren't anything that is kind of out of the ordinary that no one hasn't seen in Rocksmith before.
Sure.
You know, double stop slides on the upper strings. You know, we've had quite a few songs that have done that. It's pretty nice.
Yeah.
Great song. Fun to play.
Certainly enjoyed it myself. Yeah. And I'm thank you for the advice and for the encouragement of not embarrassing myself by playing blind. Hey, we're going to take a short break. You guys know Tim? You know Tim, right? Yeah, you remember Tim? Tim Porter, tall guy, Irish.
Yes.
Really talented. Decided to sing and play bass at the same time for our Rocksmith Live thing. Tim is one of the many people, hopefully like you, who has learned how to play guitar or learned how to play guitar better through Rocksmith. And so when we had a concert in the fall to celebrate the fifth anniversary of the franchise, we invited a few people out to San Francisco to make their stage debut with a real-life band made up of actual real-life note trackers, in fact. And we wanted to find out their story and then see what that experience would be like for them. Tim is one of the people, and Tim's video... sort of explains what his journey is. So take a look at Tim. Maybe win some of this DLC yourself. You Love Travis has some codes for this to give away. That's going to go on in chat while you watch this. And then we'll be back with our third song. And Brian McCune is here. So stick around. We'll be right back.
Oh. My name is Tim Porter, and I live in Dublin, Ireland. I'm 23 years old, and I'm having a bit of a Rocksmith experience, it seems, and I'm currently in Fantasy Studios in California. It's all amazing and beautiful and gorgeous and American. Winning a competition of this grand a scale is pretty big. I've not been flown anywhere ever in my entire life for anything like this, so trying to come to terms with it, I guess. I mean, I'm pretty chill most of the time, so I don't get in my head about an awful lot of stuff a lot of the time. But preparing for the show and everything, I was working very, very hard. Playing Rocksmith, it's a beautiful interface, and it's fun. You see all the pretty lights and stuff. And there are the challenges, like score attack and stuff. Like, I'm gonna beat my high score, you know? It's a very interactive way to practice. Like, practicing has always been a chore. Like, I've played music almost my entire life, and practicing was just the thing I didn't want to do, you know? I've played piano, and I've played tin whistle in a few traditional Irish pieces, but the expression that you can get out of a guitar through the bending of the strings and through the equipment and all of this amazing technology and input has been put into making this instrument as beautiful and wonderful as it is, you know? And it is a facility for me to express my musicianship as efficiently as possible. I am so excited, like crazy over the moon excited about this. It's gonna be a lot of fun, and it's gonna be interesting, and it's gonna be intense. It's gonna be so good. Rehearsal and soundcheck. They went pretty well, I think. I'm getting more and more confident with the band and the guys, because they are excellent. They are just the absolute best guys. They're so happy to kind of have me here, and I'm so happy to be playing with them. So being on stage, even without a crowd, is a little nerve-wracking. I'm typically not the most confident person. I have a bit of a persona that I can do, but you know, having the other guys on the stage is great, and being able to play off them. I think the most nervous I was yesterday, like evening, but I think I'm just settling into it really, really well. Like, it's all made easy by everybody around me.
Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Timothy Porter.
Even coming off the stage, saying hi to everyone, saying bye to everyone, saying thanks to everyone. Jeez, like, oh, I'm still buzzing. Dude, this is fantastic. Like, beyond fantastic. Oh, thank you so much for watching Rocksmith, all that jazz, amazing. Yes.
Yes, that's Tim, and you can say hello to Tim in our chat room right now. He's Timotorius.
Hi, Tim.
Hi, Tim. Maybe Tim's story sounds like yours, but with a different accent. I don't know. But hopefully Rocksmith is giving you the encouragement that you need to be the kind of guitarist or bassist that you would like to be. And if not, just keep playing it, because that's how it happens. My name is Dan Amrick. I'm the community developer on behalf of Rocksmith, and you have stumbled into the halfway point of the weekly Rocksmith developer live stream. These are real Rocksmith developers. Brian Pody on the side, and in the center, our mangler of musical content, Mr. Brian McCune.
It's my fault.
Freshly back from a vacation, you got to see your folks back east.
Yes, right.
And you actually worked out of a Ubisoft satellite office during that time.
Yeah, I got to work out of Red Storm for a few days. They helped us develop Rocksmith 2014. I don't know if you guys know that, but we worked with them. So
their logo's on the startup screen, but I don't think anybody understands why.
yeah, they helped us. They helped us out a lot in the development, so we have a good relationship with them. So they were happy enough to give me a desk. Actually, it was in the same room as Mark Campbell, who was in the band. He's the drummer for the band I'm going to butcher the name. Bedouin? Bedouin?
Oh, Bedouin.
Bedouin, yeah. The Snarling of Beasts unlockable. So
Arthur is downstairs saying, no, that's not how it's said.
Yeah, yeah, of course, yeah. So, I got to see him, and I couldn't believe that we worked together 4 years ago on this game.
Wow.
Yeah.
And you also got to share some meetings with the one and only UbiVertigo,
Lilly,
is suspiciously not here to moderate our chat. You love Travis. Hi, Travis.
I didn't murder him, I promise.
You're sure?
I did not murder Doug.
You wouldn't lie?
I would. It would be better if I lied about it if I did do it, but I didn't do it.
Okay.
And I'm telling the truth.
Then I somehow believe you. Our third song today from the mixtape song pack is Moon Age Daydream by David Bowie. This was one of the first songs to be revealed to the community, mm-hmm. and people were super happy. And I was wondering if you could address one thing, because we've released quite a few Bowie songs.
I was hoping you were going to bring this up.
And the funny thing is, even though we have quite a few Bowie songs,
yeah.
I still get this question from the community. When are you going to give him his own pack?
Well, so I'm going to share something that is going to be brand new information to you.
Okay.
For real. So we had him on Rocksmith One Disc. We did Rebel, and we did Man Who Sold the World. I think actually I did the note track for that one for Rocksmith One, and he's been showing up every now and then. A lot of times clearances for songs will come in at one big at one time
Clump,
for
you know.
But his stuff has been rolling in because there's so many different collaborators or publishers, and you put things out in so many different eras. So we've been getting it over time, and I just actually thought about it, and I realized I actually kind of like the idea of just sprinkling a bit of David Bowie throughout
everywhere
throughout the Rocksmith Library rather than all at once, because I don't know, he's kind of magical in that way. I feel like
nobody's ever unhappy to see a David Bowie song.
I know.
But the more technical reason for this, how come you haven't done a pack? Because we're getting them one at a time, we can't then take them out of the packs they're in and create a Bowie pack. Please don't make the mistake of thinking like if you give an artist a pack, it's because you show them respect. And if you don't give them a pack, then you must not like them.
No, that is not the truth.
That is not the case at all. Bowie is actually often used as like, well, we will have Bowie in this pack, and that's good. That'll be a good anchor, and we think people will be excited about that when we do a mixed pack. And this one, obviously, was a really good one for him to be in. But please don't be upset. Don't think that we didn't give David Bowie a pack because we don't love him.
No,
what
we
did,
love him.
We loved him so much that we decided to
spreading the love.
Yeah, well, as soon as we can get clearance on a song, it kind of goes into production.
Yeah.
Like, okay, we got a new Bowie one, fast track it, let's go. So,
and for example, he collaborated with Queen. So like for that track, that came in at a different time then, and you know. Anyway, I won't bore you with all the technicalities. But
no,
I'm happy to continue to get David Bowie out to the people. Yeah.
Brian Pody, since McCune doesn't sully his hands with note tracking anymore, I assume that you did this.
Well, if you're going to put it that way.
Yeah, he's the one who made a mess of this one.
Did you do the note track for this? I'm guessing the answer is yes.
I did.
Mangled a Daydream?
Yes.
Yeah.
Mangler of Daydreams.
Anything that you want to point out ahead of time, or you want to just play it and then see what occurs to you? If anything,
there are a
nothing
lot of solos
has
at
to.
The end.
Yeah, there are a lot of solos at the end. Brian said to me earlier, I hope you know those noodly solos are coming all right. So I actually practiced it.
Oh, wow. Yeah. So
give him a little bit of that passive aggressive pressure.
Yeah. I played it once and then I went, I shouldn't play this again before the stream because there's so many bends, I'm going to tear up my fingers.
Yeah.
Great.
It's bendy.
It's very bendy and there's some huge, huge bends in it. But yeah, great guitar parts. It's a really fun song.
All right, let's watch you suffer the bends.
Yeah.
Moon Age Daydream by David Bowie, one of the five songs in the mixtape song pack available now this week. I will take a look at the chat. I'm an alligator. I'm a mama, papa coming for you. After this, we will have some Q&A with Brian and Pody. So if you have any questions, get them warmed up and ready, and then we'll answer them after the song, or try to answer them. The Divine Sage says, you know what goes good with bends? Pinches. Don't tempt him yet.
We'll see.
He'll have opportunities. We'll
There's never a bad time to be tasteless.
So if you're wondering, those grayed out X's, those half-height panes of the X's, are mutes, palm mutes. So you you just lightly block the strings rather than press on the strings with your left hand or your fretting hand, and strum with your right. So it's just supposed to be a percussive chunk kind of sound rather than actually sounding out a note. That's why there's an X over there, because you're not really playing a note. He's trying to pinch everything. It's like an ice pick in my ear, man. I hope you're happy, chat audience. You did this.
I'm not.
Sadly, everybody really liked your pinch harmonica. You'll only encourage him.
I don't really need encouragement, is the problem.
That's true. Zaf45, who is something of our official, unofficial classic rock historian in the chat, says, fun fact, Mick Ronson improvised the outro solo on his first take. Bowie loved it, and they moved on.
That's a lot of bends.
More bends than Radiohead. I mean, I really shouldn't tell you how much people enjoyed you pinching all the way through that.
I was going to suggest you try to pinch those bar chords. It's just not possible.
That would be kind of awesome. Let me see. I actually did get... Is there anything you wanted to add about that while I'm looking for some of the questions?
I don't think the guitarist ever plays the same thing twice.
No, you actually complained a bit. about the leveling of this chart.
Yeah, it was challenging because nothing repeats ever.
Yeah, right? Yeah. That's one part of, you know, try to draw attention to this where we can. We always come on stream and we play the top level. We play the full transcription, but we do have all these gradations of difficulty that we build in. And when all of the material is unique and non-repeating, it means a lot more work for these guys because they have to find the carefully crafted way to teach you each individualized moment of inspiration that happened in that first take in
right,
the studio.
Kind of like bring in all the things that are similar so you have this base to build upon and then bring in all the variation. It's a lot more challenging than when it's like there's riff A and riff B.
Yeah.
Repeat.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Are you ready for some questions from the adoring teeming millions
sure.
out there.
The millions of fans of Pody that yes. I know that are out there.
Major Makoto asks, how do you guys deal with the audio in the songs? Do you use some technique that lowers the sound of the other guitars or bass? You guys are using the standard stereo master, right?
Yeah, yeah. So we don't have access to anything other than the two-track master. So we're getting left channel and right channel. Mm-hmm. And we do have techniques. We don't want to give away everything, but we do have, I mean, it's not a secret that you can manipulate the EQ, like bring out or diminish certain frequency ranges to make some things more audible. You can get rid mm-hmm. of the low end and make the high end
yeah,
speak.
We'll do that for transcription.
Yeah.
But what
yeah,
you're the transcription hearing in-game is just what's on the record.
Yeah, yeah. We're not doing any of that in the post. When we're analyzing the material, we do what we can, but we are only looking at that two-track stereo mix.
Dan Ueno says, Pody should do an encore on pinch harmonics. If you're not familiar with the Rocksmith Encore, what we do is once a month we do a bonus stream where we let one of the note trackers or staff members go nuts on a musical topic that matters to them. Brian McCune did the physics of sound, right? The physics yes. of audio, basically.
Yeah.
Brian Hsu did a whole bunch of really cool techniques and exercises for how you can get to play faster, better, more accurately. Basically what an awful lot of players are always looking to do. And Brian Pody could, I suppose, do an entire hour on pinch harmonics if you really want it, but I think we've got a better idea for Pody.
I don't know.
All right. If you're not familiar with Brian with Rocksmith Encore, please check our video archive here on Twitch. We've done three so far. Mm-hmm. The third one was Arthur von Nagel's incredibly comprehensive look at metal. It's basically half history and half let's actually define what the difference is between doom metal, thrash metal, mm-hmm. death metal, speed metal, pretty much, you know, twisted metal. Everything was in there. It was
he
kind
went
of ridiculous.
There. It yeah. was amazing. It was like yeah. encyclopedic was
and
the word
I used. And it's not one of those things where, oh, well, if you don't know this. He's very open. He's very enthusiastic about metal, and he was happy to have the opportunity to teach people who might be curious about it. So yeah. if you are metal curious, this is definitely yeah. The stream for you. You will learn a lot. I certainly learned a lot. And yeah. I was like, what? You're kidding me the whole time.
Among the many things I learned is that simply being a metal band that sings about Vikings does not make you Viking metal.
Yes, yeah, that's right. True.
Viking metal is its own thing. Oh man, it's so pedantic and so interesting and so deep and varied. And he brought great enthusiasm to
Here's
it.
Here's one that's close to your heart. No Maze says, did we ever decide who's doing this month's encore? No, but here's why. And this is actually a perfect segue. This week, not only are we on the last, are on a different day because we've got a scheduling conflict. At the end of this week, our studio, as you know it, our beautiful green screen for which we
yeah,
love so much.
Our blue thing.
Yeah. we are getting this entire room completely redecorated, and it is being rebuilt as a really nice streaming room. CeCe Smith, who you may know from the Werewolves Within, Werewolves Wednesday, she was actually streaming out of this room shortly before we started. She put together a really great plan for how this room should be renovated and rebuilt as a modern streaming studio instead of sort of a cobbled together thing that we like. She got a budget for some gear, and so we're using her lights mm-hmm. and her expertise and her headsets and everything. And so since this has gone so well and we've got other things that we want to stream out of this office, she said, I know what we got to do. So she put a plan together. She got that plan approved, and the contractors are coming on Friday. So the thing you need to know is that the next 2 weeks will probably they'll still be doing construction for about 2 weeks. We pre-recorded the next 2 weeks of streams, so we will be on Thursdays, our normal time, 3 p.m. Pacific, 6 p.m. Eastern, 10 p.m. GMT, but the entire shows have been pre-taped live. If you have watched any of our holiday specials, or not the specials, rather, but the holiday streams, the last week of the year, we sometimes pre-record those. We did last year for Green Day.
That's right.
Because nobody was around. You know, people take off for the holidays. So rather than skip one, we'd rather just go ahead and pre-record. So we did that for the next 2 weeks, and that is DLC pack first, and then DLC pack second. Yeah, so we know what they are. You'll know what they are soon enough, but we'll be doing the giveaways live, so absolutely do please come back. And we will tell you in the recordings that we're not live. But that means that I get to sit and sort of answer people and talk more. I get to talk even more, but you don't have to listen to me, which is going to make it wonderful for you.
You get to talk over yourself.
I do. That's pretty good. I get to be like, hey, look at me. I'm in the chat. Hey, look at me.
Damception, I think is what that's called.
That's terrible. So, yeah, that's one of the reasons, because we're not really sure what date the encore will fall on, because it is dependent on that construction. So, with that in mind, we'll let you know when we have a decision on who's doing encore. Yeah. I know what Podi is planning, and I would like to see if Podi's can go next, but it will depend very much on whether we have a room in which to stream. So we'll take that as we go.
Yeah. Did you also mention that the last Monday of this month is also a holiday in the U.S.?
Is it?
Yeah.
Oh, man.
Yeah, Memorial
Again?
Day. Memorial Day. Yeah. So that's also one of the things that we're up against. So we will communicate once we know the status of the room, the status of whether or not we're going to be in the office, which is probably not on that last Monday. So we'll figure it out, and we'll let you know as soon as we know. But right now, we don't know.
Yeah, we don't know. What has been the most difficult song you have had to note track, says A. Brown M5? This is going to be a personal question, because every note tracker obviously does a song primarily, and then they help check the work of the other people and make suggestions. Podi, would it be Hocus Pocus by Focus?
That's up there. Mostly because I just got so...
You had so much fun.
Yeah. I went a little overboard and transcribed everything. The whistling in that song was the hardest part.
Yeah.
Because trying to figure out what pitches he was on was incredibly difficult. Metropolis is probably the other
one. I was
going
to say something prog rock from last
year. Yeah, that one, like, the playing is really clear, but there's just so much going on. And again, like, I'm a big fan, so I wanted it to be super accurate in terms of positioning and everything.
Sure.
So I spent a lot of time on that one.
Yeah. For me, Hangar 18, I think that's an easy one.
Oh, wow. You did the track for Hangar 18. Yeah. Something I wouldn't have associated with you. I would have instantly said, like, oh, it's probably a Kokel track, right?
No, I did.
I played through that today.
Yeah, it was before it was before Kokel's time. I think Megadeth was, like, the second or third DLC we did. And, that was... it's difficult because there were different guitarists trading solos in that one, and I think we put all of them into one track.
They're very different character too.
Yes, yes, they are.
Stain and Marty Friedman.
Everyone is totally different.
We'll leave that there, but that the two different styles of playing. So that having to do that note track after, I mean, I probably did that note track within my first year of note tracking, having only made the handful of disc songs that I made for Rocksmith 1. I don't even know the exact number of those, but you know, having it probably be my like my 15th to 20th note track, Hangar 18 was pretty brutal. But
congratulations!
I did it as I played it in the other music game, so I knew it really well because I played it so many times. So I had the similar thing to you, where I needed that to be perfect. So. And it was.
And it was.
I hope.
No, I'm sorry. That was my cue. And it was. Yes. Yeah. If you have any more questions, we're going to get on to our final song here in a moment. But if you have any more questions, you can always reach out to us on the Twitters. We like using the Twitters a lot. Twitter.com/RocksmithGame. Also Ubisoft Studio SF if you'd like to talk specifically to the studio. We're also over on Facebook. Always, you know what? A better conversation on Facebook than you might expect from your average Facebook conversation, because we moderate that place. We don't stand for no nonsense, but actually some halfway decent conversations going on over there at facebook.com/rocksmith or /UbisoftStudioSF. What?
We plug everyone else's projects on this game.
Yay! I almost forgot. Thank you. I really almost forgot. So Dan is famous now.
No.
Dan is, well, Dan and his buddy Jude.
Okay.
Right?
Yes.
They is famous now. They are the duo known as Palette Swap Ninja, yes?
Yes.
Yes. And you guys were historically had done video game music.
Parody music. Parody like music. I like to say, it's like Weird Al, but not as funny.
Oh, the camera broke.
What?
This is our room.
Yeah, this is.
Oh, okay. So
this is part of our upgrade.
Yeah.
We need to get a situation better than this.
What we're going to get is new cameras as well as a new set.
Yeah.
Some of the furniture is here. It looks really good. But yeah, we're having a bit of a PC problem.
This is perfect.
This is why we're
upgrading the room.
The camera cutting away to the newsroom when, you know, somebody's, you know, running through, you know, getting changed or something. Oh, boy.
This is going so well. I'm so happy.
Right in the middle of my plug, too.
I know, right? Well, Dan is a part of another very professional organization. Anyway, they put out a really incredible tribute to two seminal parts of American pop culture, Star Wars A New Hope and the Beatles, Sgt. Pepper, Lonely Hearts Club.
Why are you asking me? Yes.
I just want to make sure.
Sgt. Pepper's Lonely Hearts Club Band.
I wanted to make sure I didn't butcher. Because
you don't want to butcher the Beatles.
You don't want to butcher the Beatles. That's actually a great, great, great album. So I'm going to, I know I've been, he's been so good about plugging Super Soul Bros. When I
Super Soul Bros. There's Hail the Sun. There's the Gentleman Amateurs, Greg Barr's band.
Yeah, he's been very good. I was very happy to have a moment here to let to plug Dan's work, which has been a labor of love, many sleepless nights for 5 years. Right?
Yeah, this is it was a 5-year project. We started on it in earnest with lyrics back in 2012, and the lyrics took more than a year to write. And so the next 3 years were chipping away nights and weekends when we had time. Mm-hmm. And then the last 6 months or so have been like pedal to the metal. Every waking moment, we got to get this done. So
I sit next to Dan, so I have heard all of the updates.
Oh,
over
the last... all of the complaining, all of the, oh my God, I'm so tired. Look at what I did this weekend.
Yeah, and check this out, or what should I do about this clarinet thing? It's like,
I was asking Brian a whole lot of things. As you know, the Beatles kind of complex, so we decided, what if we did, say, a cover of all of Sgt. Pepper, but instead we used that structure to tell the story of Star Wars: A New Hope, and so it's called Princess Leia's Stolen Death Star Plans, which is Sgt. Pepper's Lonely Hearts Club Band. It
and
works.
In the exact syllables. He was very, took a lot of love to make sure that everything fit just right. And it has really blown up, and people are loving it all over the internet. And can I share the highlight?
No, that's it. That's when we peaked. Sure.
The peak happened around last night, just before midnight.
Midnight.
What happened, Dan Amrick?
Mark Hamill retweeted it with very kind words and pinned it to the top of his Twitter profile, called it ingenious, and said, I'm going to need some assistance to get my jaw off the floor. So if that's not the highest compliment you can get, when Luke Skywalker himself, now it just so happens, Mark Hamill is a huge Beatles fan. So late in the process when we were doing this, we realized, oh man, like, what are the chances? He's pretty active on Twitter. There's a chance that if fans point him to it and he wants to indulge his Beatleness, like Liverpool knows when he visits, like the Chamber of Commerce is like, Mark Hamill's coming back, you know, roll out the red carpet. Like, he's a really big Beatles scholar. Mm-hmm. So it was extremely gratifying to go do all this crazy. It's just because we thought it was a good idea. It's a free album. You can download it for free. Mm-hmm. And, we figured it would take maybe a couple of days. Maybe some people would notice because tomorrow is Star Wars Day, May the 4th. And, instead, like 14 hours after we posted it, it was on a major news outlet. And then it was just off to the races. It's been ridiculous.
So I was very happy to come back to the office today to a very now even more internet famous Dan Amrick.
Oh, boy.
And I would be remiss. Is that the right word? I don't know.
Yeah, sure.
Sure. If I didn't mention I mentioned Jude, but also Dan's wife did all the video editing.
Yes.
And
the photos and the album cover and our logo and
which
everything.
Are really clever and clean and amazing.
Marry a graphic designer. It will save you so much on all of the things that you need for your little goofy band.
Cool. So any graphic designers out there? I'm currently single. So
there you go.
I'm really proud of Dan. I'm really proud of this thing. I mean, like, the things that any artistic endeavor is you do it for different reasons, and this is something you did out of place of wanting to honor and
absolutely
homage to these two things, and it came in this beautiful kind of fusion of two different elements, kind of created something new that people
have reacted to it far more positively than I thought. Like, I thought we would get sort of like I see what you did there. By the way, we're vamping for time because we're having technical problems.
Yeah,
with
the
PC. This is not just like stroking my ego, although I really appreciate
it. Pody's under a table right now.
He is.
Literally.
Wave to everybody, Pody.
Yeah, this is.
There you go.
He's below frame. He's below frame and plugging something in.
It's very, very hot in this room. I actually think that may have been something wrong with the PC. It's just overheating.
Okay. Even though we're vamping for a bit, I I'd like to say it's pretty great. I mean,
thank you.
The time and the intent it shows, and I think something that I always believe is that people will always respond, and the right people will always acknowledge when something is truly genuine and something comes from a place of love, and when you're being very real and you're not trying to just.
This was absolutely. I mean, we gave it away for free, and we decided to do like the most accurate thing because Star Wars fans are in love with Star Wars, Beatles fans are in love with the Beatles
to a rabid degree,
right? And you don't want to violate that love or respect that exists there. So we realized if we did it wrong, we were going to get it from both sides.
Yeah.
But it just so happens that Jude and I are both rabid Star Wars and Beatles fans, so it came from a very real place, and we overanalyzed every last element of both of them. There's stuff that we did on purpose that I didn't think anybody was going to notice, but people have noticed. And that's been super gratifying because, you know, some people are just like, haha, that's kind of funny. But other people are like, this is my new world, you know, and that's kind of that's very surprising.
You've given them a new hope.
It's been super, super nice to see people pass it along. And then, of course, to see like big outlets cover it and then Mark Hamill say, holy cow, this is great. It's like, you know what? There are still negative comments out there. Oh, there's people out there going like, great idea, horrible singer.
Yeah.
And I was like, well, you know what?
You know what?
But you know what? No. Because Mark Hamill liked it. So
yeah, there you go.
Go jump in a lake. Kind of like I am not worried about the haters anymore because Mark Hamill liked it. You can't get better than that. So, hey, good. Thank you, Pody.
I think we're
Pody
good
worked
to go.
His magic.
Yeah, our vamping is done. A conveniently timed computer break. I'm sure Dan didn't program that at all.
I didn't do that at all. I'm just saying Pody kicked that off, and then everything broke. So.
Yeah. So
thank
you, Pody, for letting me remember. Because we like working with Dan Amrick. He's a great person to work with. And then he's also doing this really cool stuff outside of work. So he's also a cool person.
Not anymore.
In
I
real
get to
life.
Sleep now.
Now he gets to sleep.
It's kind of great.
Yeah. So was it worth losing those
Oh, absolutely.
Those hours
no, this
of sleep?
Is this yeah. is absolutely like when it was done, I had to walk away from it for like a week while we were preparing all the like we had to bolster our website and stuff like that in case it went very, big. And of course it did, which is great. Yeah. I've sort of listened to it a little bit today for the first time. And I'm like, this is good. It's just impossible for me to be objective about it because
all I hear are the flaws.
But so if you want to get it, Kat made her videos. They're on YouTube at bit.ly/StarWarsBeatles, lowercase, that's all it is. That's probably the most fun way to enjoy the album because she has synced up film footage and you can read the lyrics as you go.
That's the best way to experience
it. And it's the whole album. So it's an 11-song playlist. But our URL is in there for our website, PaletteSwapNinja.com, and then you can download MP3 or FLAC for free if you want to listen to it outside of that. But if you only have one way to do it, watch Kat's videos. I think that sort of it dawns on you and you go, oh. And then if you're a hardcore Beatles fan, put headphones on and let's talk because I put things in there for you. And there's some John Williams scores that are woven through.
I know. I know.
Well, really deep. In 13, did you hear all the left channel stuff on track 13?
I've lived those scores. I haven't talked to you about those elements, but I'm very happy with you.
Okay. Oh, thank you.
That's part of why I'm giving this glowing review because you did the John Williams stuff right.
I thought we just – well, that's Jude's thing. Jude is the musician. I'm just the front man.
All right. Well, let's take a look at some –
yes.
Let's move on.
Yeah, people are probably stop!
Okay. So in case you missed it
– here's three number one hits that may interest you, and I have a trivia question for you, the chat room. All of these songs did go to number one. One did not go to number one in America. One went to number one in Japan. The other two did go to number one in America. Between The Runaways' Cherry Bomb, The Jackson 5, I Want You Back, and Rupert Holmes' Escape, the Pina Colada song, which was part of our Yacht Rock song pack, which one of these songs went number one in Japan but not America? Brian McCune is looking and thinking. Do you have any guesses? Brian, I'm gonna see what everybody says. The chat room, I'm saying, is pretty much unanimously agreeing that it was Cherry Bomb by The Runaways, which is exactly what Brian was gonna say. I'm sure. Yes, but all three of those songs are available now in our back catalog. Some of them are available as singles. Well, all of them are available as singles. Some of them are in individual packs. If you're liking the music that you hear in the mixtape, you might like those songs too. Just wanted to give you a heads up about that. With 1,000 songs, it's easy to lose track. But you, you know, but that's why we're here, is to help you find the DLC so that you can open your heart and your wallet to new music. Hi, Sharon.
Hey,
Sharon Marmito is back, ladies and gentlemen. Sharon is one of our producers here on the title, and people love it when you're on the stream.
I love being here.
Brian Hsu is also here, and people are pretty okay when you're on the stream.
Yep.
You know,
I like it when you're on the stream.
Sharon and Hsu are here to play our last song of the day, which is Ain't No Mountain High Enough by Marvin Gaye and Tammy Terrell. We did not play Go All the Way by the Raspberries. That makes me sad because I really like that song myself. But, you know, as it is, we've run over time as usual. So did you want to play this, or did you just jump in because we needed extra people? Or were you approached? Did somebody say, hey, can you cover this for me? How'd you get here?
I just wanted to play this song.
Okay.
So I was like, I think Travis was going to play it, and he played on like every stream this week,
right,
or whatever. So I was like, I want that one. I want that one. I want to play this.
Cool. And your piano playing is extremely impressive. I had no idea that you even played piano. She just randomly posted to Facebook, like, oh, yeah, here's like this, you know, this Bach tune, CPE Bach, right?
Yes.
Yeah. And I was like, what? I'm waiting for the camera because it's just fingers on a keyboard. I'm waiting for a camera. Like, it looks like Sharon. It looks like Sharon's hands.
It's me.
That's super cool.
Thanks,
I didn't know. That's wonderful.
I haven't played in years, and
it doesn't sound it.
I didn't
sounds
play
great.
Post a video just for funsies.
No, I'm glad you did.
Thanks.
Hsu, anything we need to know about this? James Jamerson is on the bass, so Sharon has some pretty major boots to fill. This is a wonderful bass line.
It's so fun.
Yeah.
It's probably the hardest one that I'm jumping on this.
Good.
This time around.
Yeah, he's like a Motown legend, so he's just kind of all over the place, like kind of like the. What chart did I? Anyways, it's pretty. He improvises a lot, and it's just all over the place. The lead arrangement of this tune is actually the vocal arrangement. So there's actually two vocal arrangements for both Marvin and Tammy. So originally they were just both in the same arrangement, but now they're in separate arrangements. So two lead players can kind of play both their parts.
Oh, and that's really nice.
It's like a Iron Maiden, but ain't no mountain
Iron,
high enough.
Iron Motown, if you will. Yeah.
So the rhythm part's just kind of a hum and strum guitar part that I made to fit the harmony of this tune.
And is that what you're going to play?
Mm-hmm.
All right.
Yeah.
Excellent. Let's do it. Ain't No Mountain High Enough, Marvin Gaye and Tammy Terrell, part of the 5-song mix tape song pack, available now in Rocksmith. On all platforms, believe it's out there and everything is fine. Going to skip the tuner. Remember, if you know that you're in tune, or if you want to roll the dice with the remastered patch, you can now skip the tuner on command before a song. That was something that you, the players, asked us to add in so that you could get to playing faster. that was no joke as bass lines go. Many people noting that you were really, you're very fast. They said Sharon's got this one nailed. They were very happy to see you. Sharon has quick fingers, says Bisco Bid.
I think that's the best I got. Actually.
Yeah, that's really good.
No, that was like, that was wonderful. 96%
like
on
95 this whole week every time practicing
on a Jamerson track too. Yeah. That's like ridiculous. Mm-hmm. And you, Mister, I went to Berkeley, so let me throw in. Aren't you one of those Berkeley people? Aren't you part of the Berkeley Mafia?
No, that's Sam.
Are you MI?
Yeah, I'm.
Yeah, you're MI. Oh, so do you guys have like knife fights and stuff when we're not around?
No.
Well, I don't. You're using all these jazz chords, man. I don't believe these chords actually existed in Rocksmith before you came up with them. That was not the easiest. You're like, oh, it's a hum and strum. When I think of hum and strum, I think of the open chords, the cowboy chords, as Jared likes to call them. Mm-hmm. You know, like a standard C, a D, anything with three frets and the nut, and that's mm-hmm. it. It's just all here.
Yeah.
And you're up here doing all kinds of crazy stuff.
Yeah, there's a couple of like inversions, and it's a little jumpy in some parts, but. A lot of it is just kind of the moving bass line underneath the top of the triad. So like, for the main part, it's literally, and then just the bottom note is just going down chromatically,
right,
like that. So it's not too bad. And then,
I'll be the judge of that. I like to play rhythm guitar, so, and you know, my wife plays bass, so she will play the bass, and I'll be stuck trying to figure out mm-hmm. that. Or maybe I'll do one of the leads, the representative leads, the vocal leads. But, given the fact of what this material was, I actually think that's pretty cool that you were able to put the two vocal leads together. Because, I don't know, I love the song, and I always have. So when this cleared, I was so excited. And I'm thinking about this bass line. This is, like, to me, one of the ones that just defines Jamerson. So if you're not familiar, James Jamerson is the bassist on this. Go to the Googles, go around, and find out what he's played on. You have probably heard what that guy has played on. But, yeah, incredible, tasteful, and beautiful bass all the way through. So I think that's it, unless you have anything else, because we've got another giveaway. We've got one more thing to give away, and it's this. It's the Ernie Ball prize pack. For you, everything you see here is going to one winner. That's the regular Slinky bass strings, 50 to 105, so a good sort of middle of the road kind of gauge. You can do anything you need to do on bass in most cases. Plus 10 to 46 regular Slinkies. That's also a really good workman-like gauge, if you will. Very good for lead, very good for rhythm, sort of sits in the middle. And most guitars kind of come strung with 10s on them. So if you're not even sure what you have on there, you might have 10s, and so these you wouldn't have to do anything. Just put new ones on. Brand new peg winder, which will help make your string changes go a little bit faster, a little bit more efficient. Brand new strap. At the moment, they are silver. We're showing a black one, but they are silver. And that rotates because whatever Ernie Ball has a lot of, that's what they send to us, and that's cool. Brand new little sampler pack of Wonder Wipes. These are pre-moistened towelettes for cleaning your strings, moisturizing your fretboard, and polishing your guitar. Once you start using these, you will find out just how darn handy they are. I highly recommend them. Also, you've got a dozen of Ernie Ball's picks as well. At the moment, they are camo-colored. So, you know, if you lose them, we can't help you find them. And the Rocksmith picks are some of our like to call these the tuxedo picks. They're black and white with the Rocksmith logo on one side and the special 1,000 vinyl record design that we came up with for some of our internal stuff. You may have seen our T-shirts in the past for the 1,000 song milestone when we reached that on Rocksmith. So once these are gone, they're gone. We're only doing 1,000 of them. So perhaps that's you. You could get a handful of these in the mail. You Love Travis has been our special guest moderator today. He is handling the Moobot giveaway for this right now. If you win this, or if you won the previous one that we gave away earlier in the show, then all you need to do is send your name, your address, and your phone number, not information that we use for anything else. We don't save it. Just have to give the phone number to the mailroom. The mailroom gives your phone number to, like, UPS in case they can't find you. Rather than have them send it back to us, they'll just contact you directly and say, where the heck do you live anyway? And that way you get your stuff faster without it being returned to us. So don't worry about giving us your information. We won't use it for anything evil. But good luck. Send him that information. If you're the winner, send it right away, because then I can get the box boxes off of my desk right away, and I like to do that. I like you to win. So next week we will be at our normal time, Thursday, 3 p.m., 6 p.m., 10 p.m., depending on where you are in the globe. You've seen our graphic. You'll know. And we will be chatting live and doing prize giveaways live, but the actual show and performances are already pre-recorded, and it's a pretty good show. I was actually really happy with that pre-record. I've been very busy week because every day we've basically done a stream that no one has seen. But thanks again to CC for getting us a brand new studio. This is the last you're going to see of. I got to talk about my stools here. We used to do this on an IKEA couch. And David Stevens actually said, could we get stools? Because stools would be a lot easier for us to play. You know, we're upright and we, you know, we don't have to sink into a couch and we would like sort of squeeze in with each other. And if you watch some of our early streams, you can see that our early set design was non-existent. That's the word I'm looking for. And so I asked in facilities, our facilities team here at Ubisoft said, yeah, would these work? And they brought in these really cool like bar stools with sparkly blue and purple vinyl. And I love them. And I am one of the only people that loves them. They were in a storage closet. Nobody was using them. And Cece does not particularly like this. She has better taste than I do. And so that's why you're going to be glad when you see our new set. It was designed with Cece's taste. We will still have stools, but I swear to God, they look awesome. And I'm sorry. Goodbye, Blue Stool. You were my favorite, Blue Stool. So stick around. You know, the next couple of weeks, you're going to see some more of this set. But after that, new set, same old goofballs doing the stream, though. So we hope you enjoy that part. We can't upgrade that. There's nothing to be done. We're going to leave you with a look at the Mixtape Song Pack DLC song trailer. 5 songs this week. Hopefully you like classic 70s rock and soul because that's what we have on tap. Really fun kind of stuff to play and really fun stuff to hear and sing along with. Perhaps if you're looking for something that you might not think that your family expects you to play, maybe one of these 5 songs would do it. So take a look at that. We'll see you next week, Thursday, 3 p.m. Pacific, 6 p.m. Eastern. Thanks very much, everybody. Have a good weekend. I'm hooked on